When Hurricane Sandy made its way towards the East Coast in the fall of 2012, residents knew it could be devastating. What they didn't expect was just how bad Sandy turned out to be. 117 deaths and damage estimated at more than $60 billion, second only to Katrina. More than 2.5 years later, Sandy victims have been hit by something else they didn't expect, the storm after the storm. As we first reported in March, many people say they have been cheated out of their insurance claims. Thousands of claims have still not been resolved, and there is evidence that many homeowners were victims of what appears to be wide-scale fraud, where original damage reports were later changed to make it look like the damage wasn't as bad. Making matters worse, appeals to the federal agency in charge of all of this, FEMA, went nowhere.
The FEMA-run National Flood Insurance Program appears riddled with widespread cheating.
Thousands say they have become victims again.
In the aftermath of Sandy, thousands of New Jerseyans faithfully paid their flood insurance programs for years, often decades, without ever making a claim, and then had the rug pulled underneath from them when they were significantly underpaid by FEMA's private insurance contractors.
Everything that you worked so hard in your life to get is now gone.
But you had flood insurance.
Mm-hmm.
You'd paid for every month.
Absolutely.
Did you think you were okay?
Sure. I mean, that's what you pay insurance for.
I had to journey deep into the complex world of flood coverage. The search took me to New Orleans and a high-stakes legal battle. John Houghtaling is a bit of a New Orleans legend, a plaintiff's attorney with a taste for French antiques.
So it's restored just like at the time.
He made millions for his clients and for himself, taking on the insurance companies after Katrina.
Insurance policies, even for a lawyer that's been doing this for a long time, they're very complicated. I mean, they're thick. If you've ever tried to read an insurance policy, it's very difficult to read. It's not written plain language. There's lots of loopholes in it, lots of exclusions.
So everybody here is working on Sandy, and these are the clients that we represent.
After Sandy, Houghtaling focuses law firm's attention on problems developing with flood claims in New York and New Jersey.
I looked at some of the cases, and I had never seen anything worse in my entire career.
He eventually signed on to represent about 600 Sandy victims in lawsuits against 20 insurance companies. And he says the companies used a variety of ways to systematically underpay homeowners.
If you look at this, all of these neighborhoods were all underpaid uniformly. They used the same process to underpay everybody.
It's hard to look at profit numbers after Sandy when tens of thousands of people believed that they were underpaid by the insurance companies and see that the insurance companies walked away with $400 million in profit. How do you explain that?
Let me ask you in a different context. Write your owns. FEMA contracts with private insurance companies to sell and service its flood insurance policies, despite taking on none of the risk. These write your owns, as they're known, reap significant profits from the program. In fact, estimates show that the write your owns pocketed more than 43 cents of every dollar in premiums in the year Sandy hit. That's an awful lot of money for an insurance company that doesn't bear any of the risk. Is it appropriate for these private companies that have no skin in the game to receive more than a third of all premiums collected?
Because the government's National Flood Insurance Program pays for claims and covers the insurance company's costs, Bell argues that engineers and adjusters have no incentive to lower damages. They get paid either way. But Houghtaling says it's FEMA that's motivated to lowball policyholders, as it tries to save a federal insurance program that's $25 billion in the red.
Right. FEMA looked me in the eye and said, we have seen this fraud. We understand it now. We will make sure these people are not in the program again. And from what I understand, they're back at work.
You're familiar with the flooding we had in March and April of last year in Louisiana. I know you're very familiar. Why is U.S. Forensic still doing engineering work now in Louisiana?
So I cannot prohibit the use of a company unless we have gone through a complete debarment process. The convicted company has been debarred. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, that's the collaboration that we are doing with the Inspector General.
The federal judge in New Jersey accuse this particular firm, these are the judge's words, not mine, of reprehensible gamesmanship. That's not enough to get you off the list?
Based on that, we worked and are continuing to supply information to the state's attorney general in New York and New Jersey, who have the law enforcement capabilities to take actions against them.
Okay. Allegedly, the engineering reports would go into the home office on all of these cases. Go into the home office, and someone in the home office would change the report. Not only change the conclusions, but would change the facts.
That's Metairie-based plaintiff's attorney John Houghtaling talking about U.S. Forensic. He represented more than 1,000 Sandy flood victims, including Deborah Ramey and her husband Bob Cable in Long Beach, New York. In 2015, 60 Minutes told the story of how U.S. Forensic changed an engineer's report that originally said Ramey's house was a total loss.
This is Andrew Brom, the engineer who could no longer stay silent. Brom told us not only were changes made to his engineering reports, but he was asked to cover it up. He showed us the original report he'd written about the damage to John and Gail Miro's house.
We assess in the conclusions hydrodynamic forces, hydrostatic forces due to the flood caused a cracking and shifting throughout the foundation.
So you're saying the flood caused this damage?
Correct. And then in the revised or the altered report, it says settlement due to consolidation of soil caused the foundation wall to crack. That's not what I wrote. It's completely altered.
Brom inspected more than 180 homes after Sandy, working for a company called High Rise Engineering. After he discovered the changes made to the report he wrote about the Miro's home, he went back to check all the copies of his original reports against the final copies that the homeowners received.
How many of those reports were doctored?
At least 175 of them, or approximately 96% is the number that I calculated.
175 of your reports were doctored?
Correct. They were altered.
And the ones that weren't changed?
The ones that weren't changed, interestingly, were ones where I recommended that no repairs are required.
Brom says High Rise Engineering pressured him to sign an affidavit saying he agreed with their final reports. He says he ignored the request and never did it.
Do you think they were trying to cover up something?
Now, knowing what I know, yes.
We had 5 whistleblowers that I have statements from, affidavits from. I'll read you the quote from 2 of them. We received instructions not to conduct a comprehensive evaluation of claims. We were directed to tailor evaluations to fall within a range, even if we identified additional covered damage. That was one of your employees that was a whistleblower. Another said there was an elaborate process designed to justify minimum payments to policyholders irrespective of the actual merits of the claim. Mr. Wright, this is completely unacceptable. $300 million of additional funds paid that would have been denied but for the pressure that was on your agency. You are charged with helping the very people that have suffered the most, and my constituents got cheated, and so did others across New Jersey and across New York, and you have to fix that. You have to fix that process so that people at least are getting paid what they are owed, and it doesn't create a gap that keeps them out of their home for years after these events.
Is our country in a good place in terms of the next disaster?
No, we're not in a good place. You can look at any of these big disasters and ask yourself the most basic question. Did we put a bunch of money out? Yes. Is everybody mad? Yes. Did people get what they needed to get back into a home? No. Is there a grand strategy, national resilience strategy, that says this is how we're going to deal with these big disasters when they happen? No, it's not there.
I don't think enough people know the different areas that can be affected by storms like this, and something has to be set up, because I don't think we could bounce back if it happened again.